Man kann start.
It's a pleasure to welcome back Professor Marcus for his lecture number five.
First, information, what does it mean? Does it need a definition? I think most people don't need a definition for information. So the first temptation would be to take it as a primitive term, not defined. However, we find that it is used in various fields with different meanings. For instance, in a Dictionary of Communication, 93, Lucien Sverre, any statement that can be answered to a question, this is information. Now I propose you this intellectual exercise to check the value of such a definition. And to be more precise, are there statements that cannot be answered to some question? This is given us arbitrary statement, meaningful statement. Is there always a question to which the given statement is an answer? Edgar Morin, great French contemporary philosopher, he says, information means organization. And this is, as a matter of fact, reminds thermodynamics. Swenson, information means signification. So, it is a way to avoid one of the most difficult problems today, how to distinguish between information and sign. Abraham Moles, 86. Information is any message containing something new. But I ask you, is it novelty, something simpler than information? Could you accept novelty as something clearer than information? In social science, information takes frequently the form of social indicators. I spoke about them in my previous lectures. For some semioticians, information means just sign. And to proceed chronologically, I will start with Charles Sanders Peirce, the great American mathematician from the 19th century. He says, connotation is the meaning of a term. Denotation is its applicability. A representation having connotation but no denotation is a copy. If it denotates having no connotation, it is a sign. In computer, look, this is a, but this is from the early works of Peirce, because along the time he changed his minds very frequently. In computer science, information takes often the form of data that may have a self-referential capacity because there are data about other data. So theory of databases has to face some paradoxes, as it was shown by Peter Otzel and Jan Barweis by their hypersets. There are also so-called information systems under the form of matrices, where lines refer to some objects, while columns refer to some attributes. We insert one and zero according to the presence or the absence of the respective objects to the respective attributes. For instance, the theory of rough sets by Zdzislaw Pawlak starts with such information system. Here I have to remark, this is a general remark which distinguishes two kinds of entities. Entities like information, communication, meaning have a self-referential capacity. We can speak about information, about information, communication, about communication, meaning of meaning, in contrast with physics, tennis, geology, chemistry, biology. They don't have this referential capacity. Except the case you want to use them metaphorically, but if you accept metaphor, the way is open to everything. Now, there are two itineraries. What I tell you now, you will find in no book. No author makes these distinctions, and I propose it to you for criticism. There are two itineraries in the study of information. The quantitative itinerary, starting with thermodynamics, and the qualitative itinerary, starting with Darwinian biology. The Greek morph became, by distortion, I don't know, I was not able to find the answer. The Greek morph became the Latin form, leading to the verb informare in Latin. Informare means to give a form, to put it in form. Now, here I have to be precise, because the idea of a form is very old, and there is a Plato has also a theory of forms, but I am not able to go so far in the past, and I start with 19th century. So, according to its etymology, information should be a qualitative entity. If it is related to form, it should be a qualitative entity. And this fact is respected by the second itinerary, but not by the first itinerary. We could also consider, according to what was said before, that the qualitative itinerary has also some roots in Peirce's semiotics, not only in Darwinian biology. We will follow these itineraries, but we warn about the sad fact that all attempts to bridge the respective itineraries, and there were many, all these aspects failed. It is a failure in the attempt to bridge these two itineraries in a unique, coherent representation of information. So, you will see what happened. We had to bring in attention some other concepts besides information. So, I start with the quantitative itinerary. Toward the middle of the 19th century, thermodynamics tries to find out the conditions under which various non-mechanical energies can be transformed in mechanical energy. In this perspective, Information is identified with order and organization, as opposed to disorder, chaos, and entropy. More precisely, information is a degree of remoteness from thermodynamic equilibrium. Basic concept of thermodynamics belong to Clausius, Boltzmann, and Helmholtz. But there is also a third itinerary. I did not consider it from the beginning because for me, information in telegraphic communication belongs to the first, to the thermodynamic itinerary. And it starts in 1924 with Harry Nyquist, who proposes to evaluate the speed V of transmission of a telegraphic message by this expression, by this logarithmic expression. Logarithm is dominating the whole itinerary, the whole quantitative itinerary of information is dominated by the logarithmic function, where k is a constant depending on the number of modulations that the system can transmit in a second, while n is the number of signs or signals existent in the system. But then, an important name, Hartley, in 1928, proposes to measure information by the logarithms of the inverse of probability. The quantity of information transmitted by a signal S is the logarithm of the inverse of the probability of appearance of S. But all states of the system, and this is a restriction in Hartley, all states of the system have the same probability of appearance. As a matter of fact, Hartley, we could say, is the first who had the idea to introduce a unit of measure of information. And as a matter of fact, he could be considered the first author trying a mathematical approach to information. Now, from Hartley to Shannon, Hartley, as I said, is the first using the word information in a mathematical sense, suggesting a unit of measurement of information. He prepares a way to Claude Shannon, 48, who considers systems with states of various probabilities. An initial probability distribution is given for all states. Shannon ignores the semantic information. He works only with selective information. This is the price he has to pay in order to make possible the measurement of information. He specifies clearly semantic aspects of communication are irrelevant for the engineering problems. Here you can see something very interesting. What in some respect is the genius of Shannon to realize that we have to ignore meaning in order to can measure the information, for later, for many other authors, was considered a shortcoming. The fact that Shannon is not able to capture the semantic information. Shannon articulates information and control. In order to make possible the detection and the correction of errors, we learn that with k control digits, we can check simple errors in 2 power k minus 1 information sequences. The basic theorem in Shannon theory articulates five components: message, source, code, channel, and noise. It says, if the entropy of the source is not larger than the capacity of the channel, then there exists a coding which makes the message safe up to a number of errors as small as we want. Now, we can go farther and realize that this bold metaphorical transfer from information and entropy from thermodynamics to the field of information follows, gives rise to an information analog of the second principle of thermodynamics. Look here, the square, you have thermodynamics entropy related to cinetic energy by means of the second principle of thermodynamics. A bold metaphorical transfer from thermodynamic entropy to information entropy. Similarity of mathematical expression between cinetic energy and information energy. Information energy is the sum of the squares of the probabilities of the state of the system. And between information entropy and information energy, introduced by Onișescu in 65, you have an analog of the second principle of thermodynamics. One of them is increasing when the other is decreasing. So, merits and shortcoming of Shannon's approach. His statistical theory of information shows its basic merits when dealing with the global aspects of communication, because its main parameters, entropy and redundancy, are global characteristics. But when we have to cope with individual and local aspects, such as those occurring in molecular biology, Shannon's theory fails in this respect. For example, and this is a failure also of classical probability theory, but you can observe by a simple example. If you compare these two binary sequences of length 8, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. Obviously, the first sequence is less random, it is not at all random, than the second sequence. But the classical probability theory is not able to make this distinction. It gives the same probability of appearance to both sequences, 1 to 2 power 8. Well, these shortcomings of classical probability theory were bridged in some respects by Robinson non-standard analysis, where you no longer have this discrepancy between zero probability and impossibility. In classical probability theory, the fact that an event has zero probability does not mean that it is impossible. Only the converse is true. If it is impossible, it has probability zero, but from the fact that it has probability zero, does not follow that it is impossible, no? The probability for a real number to be rational is zero, but this is not impossible. Bridging the gap, algorithmic theory of information. It was proposed by Kolmogorov, 65, then Chaitin, 66. This theory aims to describing the information theoretical complexity of individual messages, of individual inputs or outputs of a communication process. The main idea is to measure the information theoretical complexity of an individual object by the size of the smallest program computing the respective object. So, in the case of messages expressed by a finite sequence of binary digits, we have a new idea of randomness than that promoted in classical probability theory. Let n be the length of such a sequence, and let Cn, its information theoretic complexity. Cn is never larger than n, because one can always compute the sequence by listing its terms item by item. The sequence is considered random if Cn is equal to n, or more exactly, if Cn is not significantly smaller than n, but this significantly smaller receives a rigorous meaning. A typical example of a sequence near to a random one, where randomness is proved to be rather a matter of degree than a sharp property. Random, not random, no. Less or more random is the output of a sport competition under the form of an hierarchy that cannot be compressed in no way. The hierarchy of countries, the Olympic Games, for instance. A second example is given by some pieces of poetry. You know, I moved to a completely different field. A poetic text. You know, it is a common thing to say, poetry, you cannot make an abstract of a poetic text. It is its own abstract. You cannot compress it. You see these ideas very familiar in the field of poetics corresponds just to the basic idea of randomness. Now let us compare Kolmogorov-Chaitin with Shaman. Information theoretic complexity is a kind of algorithmic complexity and plays in the Kolmogorov-Chaitin approach the role which information entropy has in Shannon approach. The former is of an algorithmic nature, while the latter is of a probabilistic nature. Various attempts have been made to describe artistic communication in terms of information entropy, but the claim that this parameter has a tendency to reach its highest possible values in artistic communication remained very controversial. See, I gave a critical presentation in my book, Mathematische Poetik. If Shannon's fundamental theorem is related to entropy, Chaitin's fundamental theorem concerns the information theoretic complexity, and asserts that within a given formal system S, one cannot obtain a theorem stating that a specific object is of a substantially greater information complexity than the information complexity of the set of axioms of S. This is an information version, or if you want, an information interpretation or explanation of Gödel's incompleteness theorem. It follows that information processes are at the roots of human reason, and consequently, communication processes cover a very large spectrum of interactions. Gödel, Shannon, and Chaitin reveal hidden, genuine restrictions that rule human reason and human behavior, and they all prove to be of a communication nature. Unfortunately, algorithmic information complexity is not computable, and this reduces considerably its practical impact. Now, a long debate. To what extent is information objective, and to what extent it is not objective? All classical studies about information follow what I said yesterday when I talk about the subject-object distinction. All classical approaches took as a basic assumption, even if not explicitly expressed, the existence of a sharp distinction between subject and object. So they referred always to objective information. Now, according to this view, the communication process has several components and several functions. I have to tell you that the list I give you here is not the list you find usually in the works about communication. Usually only six components are given, and they differ because the list here is I made this list by taking in consideration different sources. Karl Bühler, 33, Shannon, 48, Colin Cherry, 57, Roman Jakobson, 60, also Rudolf Carnap, Peirce, Václavik, Divin, and Jackson, the protagonist of the school, Palo Alto School of Psychotherapy. So, some components, for instance, I tell you, source, destination, message, they exist to Bühler. Shannon considers transmitter, receiver, noise. Noise is considered that only the physical noise is considered by Shannon. And what I added here also, the logical and the semantic noise. Code. Then Jakobson renounced to noise and to code, to coder and decoder, and he obtained six functions. Palo Alto School introduced the observer under the form of therapeutic observing. Carnap, Peirce, Frege, they considered what I called here intentional meaning, extensional meaning. There are various variants for these things. Each component fulfills a definite function. Source, expressive or emotive function. Receiver, reception, and so on. You have them here. And as I showed yesterday, these functions, to some extent, stimulate each other. They are in a synergetic relation, but to some extent, they are in conflict. So the whole process of communication is a very something of very high complexity. We are not yet able to handle. I think that Roman Jakobson wrongly renounced to the noise and to the perturbation function, which seems to me very important in human communication. It is not important. I understand that he renounced to it because Shannon considered only physical noise. But he ignored that there is also logical noise and semantic noise. Now the problem is, but this is not on my slides, a basic question. You know, we are accustomed, and most researchers are accustomed, to associate communication and information. The aim of communication is to convey meaning, information, and the main aim of information is to be vehiculated by a communication process. Things are not so simple. There are a lot of communication processes which convey no information. Several authors were concerned with this, for instance, religious communication. It tries to influence our state of mind. You cannot say that it conveys information. What information is conveyed by a piece of poetry? Obviously. But here, examples are of very heterogeneous type because the dictatorship discourse under communism was also very frequently a discourse devoid of information. It was only aimed to influence our state of minds. For instance, to accept that we are living in the golden age of Romanian history. Now, the aboutness assumption and the double face of communication processes. The scheme of communication position shows the double face of human communication. One face oriented towards mathematics, mathematical, physical, engineering, and computational aspects, while the other face is oriented towards social sciences and the humanities. But a common denominator for all authors contributing to the above representation is what I say, the fact that they all assume, at least implicitly, that communication processes and the information they convey are about some events, phenomena, ideas that are exterior to the communication process. In other words, there is a clear separation between the process of communication and the object of communication. Moreover, it is tacitly assumed that communication is about something that already exists and is not sensibly influenced by it. Well, there are some exceptions, but in most cases, this is the case. it is not sensibly influenced by it. If we have included in the scheme both the process and the object of communication, you observe, for instance, observer. The observer is in out of the process of he observes the process, but it is not in the process. For instance, it is a very difficult exercise to precise for each component to what extent it belongs to the process or to the object of communication. For instance, the intentional meaning, the extensional meaning, the context, they don't belong to the process of communication. They belong to the to what communication is referring. The noise also is external. It affects the process, but it is, does not belong to the process. Bühler, Jacobson, and Bakhtin, and other authors have different ways to interpret the object of communication. But for all of them, again, communication is about something that happens beyond the process of communication. Something which is stable and the same for both the addresser and the addressee. Addresser means source, and addressee means destination. So you see here again the power of the presuppositions related to the Galileo-Cartesian-Newtonian paradigm of the past centuries. Attempts to capture objective semantic information. Lewis and Popper. Gilbert Lewis, 1930, much before all these authors I quoted, which Nyquist, for instance, the first one was in 31. Gain in entropy means loss of information, nothing more. Reflection symptomatic of a moment when the thermodynamic concept of entropy was already very familiar, while the idea of information entropy was only in a preliminary stage. Karl Popper, in his famous The Logic of Scientific Discovery, 34, much before Shannon, 14 years before Shannon's theory, observed as a matter of fact what anticipates exactly the philosophy of Shannon's theory. A statement says about empirical reality exactly what it prohibits about it. A negative way to define information. We say we capture information by saying what is out of it. Thus, Popper implicitly adopts the assumption that information is measured by its capacity to reduce the indeterminacy of the universe. This rather negative way of conceiving information is just the one adopted later by Shannon. But Shannon makes never, you know, mathematicians don't look too much to what is outside mathematics. The optimism of Abraham Moles, of Max Benze, and of Rudolf Arnheim. In the first years following Shannon's theory, various attempts were made to apply it to works of art, mainly to painting, visual arts. They were stimulated by the ideas of George Birkhoff concerning aesthetic measures. It was his report to an international congress of mathematicians. In this respect, Abraham Wolf's Theorie de l'Information, Fred in 58, and Max Benze, a French and a German authors, they trusted very much the capacity of Shannon information to capture, to be relevant in visual arts, and also to some extent in music, less in literature. Rudolf Arnheim also has Basic Art and Visual Perception, very important books, by University of California Press, Berkeley, 74. Unfortunately, this optimism did not receive confirmation. Carnap, Barhillel, Hintika, and Sapis try to bridge meaning with Shannon information theory. In contrast with Moles, Benze, and Arnheim, the authors mentioned in this title are aware of the insufficiency of Shannon's approach and try to supplement it with new capacities able to capture the semantic information. It seems that the syntagm semantic information was first used by Rudolf Carnap and Yoshua Barhillel in their common work published in 52. Their basic assumption that, I quote them, the semantic content of a statement is the class of all possible states of the universe excluded by it. Does not go beyond Popper's above mentioned explicit assumption. And Shannon's implicit hypothesis according to which information is viewed as an element reducing the indeterminacy of the world. I don't see something new in respect to Popper in what say Rudolf Carnap and Barhillel. Later, in the same order of ideas, we should quote Jaco Hintika, 68, who states that in the information content of a statement is given by the number of alternatives excluded by it. Various variants of the same idea. And Hintika Sapis, information and inference, information of a statement S is the amount of uncertainty we are relieved of when we come to know that S is true. All their different versions of the same basic principle remind us of the idea to define thermodynamic information as a degree of remoteness from thermodynamics equilibrium. Attempts to bridge information and sign. A sign is a triad of a representant, an object of, for instance, you have the notion of a horse, the animal we call horse, and the word horse. The study of sign processes is called semiotics, with a history of several millennia. The founder of modern semiotics is the mathematician and the logician Charles Sanders Peirce, 19th century and beginning of the 20th century. One of his followers is Charles Morris. And the first bridge between Shannon information theory and semiotics in Morris' version was proposed by Doede Nauta Jr., The Meaning of Information, 78, who interpret Shannon information as potential information and distinguishes different level of information, discursive, syntactic, semantic, pragmatic, the last one being the most important, because it is mostly involved in reducing uncertainty about environment. A more general approach to information is proposed by Jan Barweis and John Berry, Situations and Attitude, where you have a qualitative way to look at information. And information is a relation between two different situations. This is why their work is called Situations and Attitude. Jan Barweis is a well-known author in the field of logic. From communication about the world to communication about communication. As we have shown in our lecture, Science Today versus Science Yesterday, there are many situations in which a circularity appears between subject and object, leading to the circularity of the information and of the communication involved there. But one can see that even the so-called communication based on objective information leads ultimately to self-preference. Let us try the following experiment. Take a newspaper and look at the kind of news it contains. Except those concerned with natural disasters, crimes, deaths of some personalities, all news are of the type communication about communication, comments about comments of comments of other comments, and so on. What A said about what B said, who about what C said, and so on. So, to the extent to which the operator communication about is iterated, we reach versions more and more far from the initial facts generating these processes. Taking into account that each communication process introduces some distortion. There is a game children play with the telephone that each of them says something to the other, and at the end the message is completely distorted. We get an accumulation of distortions leading to versions whose link with the initial step is weaker and weaker. The real world is replaced step by step by a communication world, which is more and more independent from the real world behind it. Another example is a huge enterprise of scientific research reflected by Science Citation Index, for instance, where what you have there, you learn that A was cited by B, B was cited by C, C was cited by D, and this is an endless chain of citations. We never know the initial state. In most cases, initial state is not known. And obviously, we never know if this chain, when it will it finish, or if it will finish some time, some moment. So, the forgotten initial state, this is what happens. Imagine a hierarchy of the communication processes in the way Russell defines the hierarchy of types in set theory and Tarski defines the hierarchy of languages. Define primary communication as that type of communication that does not require to be checked by another communication process. For instance, as in the case when we trust some news items without feeling the need of checking them from another source. But there is a rule in journalism that you never give a news before checking it from different sources. So it would be better to conventionally adopt some communication processes as primary communication. Intuitively, it is a communication referring directly to reality. But this communication is weaker and weaker. Define then communication of the second order as communication about primary communication. And communication of order n plus 1, the communication about n order communication. Or p order, where p is not larger than n. Each step in this process is one more step in betraying the previous steps, in distorting them. Each new medium and new step in this iterative process has a feedback effect on the previous steps by distorting them. Primary communication is the main victim of this iterated distortion. So even if it is not forgotten, we no longer have its initial image, what we call the real world. It's step by step replaced by a communicational world having its own rules. I gave in another paper the example of what happens under communism. People in Eastern Europe did not trust primary communication. They did not trust what we were able to see directly with their eyes. And they replaced this by listening to Western radio, Voice of America, etc. This means they preferred communication of higher order in our hierarchy to communication of lower order, of primary communication. Primary communication was compromised because it was always suspected that behind it there is a scenario which is completely different from what the open communication said. Primary communication accepted by the official media was suspected to hide a scenario, and this scenario was revealed by Western radio. Another communicational shock occurs when higher order communication is using a medium different from the one used in the lower order communication. It is very difficult in this case to check the former by means of the latter, because people lose the habit of coping with the previous medium. Like now, no? We have the internet, and most people in young generations, they don't like to go to classical libraries. They use only what they find on internet. Now, from being to becoming, this is, you know, from the title of a famous book by Prigozhin, there is a general tendency to marginalize the initial state and to pay attention to the move from one state to the next one. Peirce does not insist on what is a sign intrinsically, but how one sign leads to another sign. There is no initial sign in his approach to semiosis, which is always infinite, and there is no final sign too. Let us take the history of the universe. Scientific laws do not determine the initial state of the universe at the level of a singularity, but only its further evolution. Hawking, Penrose. The singularities of a gravitational collapse in cosmology. In general relativity theory, the initial state of the universe is a point of infinite density. And it is very difficult to formulate limit conditions of the universe at such a point. This situation led Stephen Hawking in a recent book to assert that the initial state of the universe is the absence of any initial state. A similar situation we find in biology. The phenomenon called life is approached as a self-referential process, and this is the reason why it was simulated by a self-reproducing automaton for Neumann, while the associated so-called Conway's game of life simulates how life derives from life. How life derives from life. Not being, but becoming. For the whole problem, see Klaus Emeke's The Computational Notion of Life, a very important paper. Another significant example is the concept of a stream. Occurring in computer science is the study of communication systems. What is a stream? It is defined as a couple A, S prime, where a stream S is defined as a couple A, S prime, where A is an object from a definite set of objects, while S prime is another stream. And it can be shown that streams, very useful in the study of databases, lead to some self-referential phenomena related to the so-called hypersets considered by Peter Otzel. So, we don't know what is a stream intrinsically. We learn only how streams proceed from other streams. Now, if you remember, I said at the beginning that there are two itineraries of information. Everything I told you so far was about the quantitative itinerary. And I left for the end because it is the most richest one and the most complicated information as form in the first, I don't know what time is now. I am afraid that no time, but you will decide if you accept to. I have 4 pages about the itinerary of information as form. And this is a very telegraphic itinerary because it is so rich, but people are so ignorant about it. I hope you will support. First, information as form in the 19th century. I will be very brief. Darwin, Haeckel, within the frame of the principle of natural selection of success in reproduction. So, this seems to me very important. Towards the end of the 19th century, the German biologist Augustus Weismann expressed the premonitory opinion according to which, I quote him, the biology of heredity cannot be explained in terms of matter and energy only. We need something more, and we call it information. I repeat, this was said in the 19th century. Such a statement is just in the spirit of the second half of the 20th century. Another qualitative line versus semiotics. The mathematics of the 19th century is very rich in development of qualitative aspects qualitative theory of algebraic equations, Galois, or differential equations, Poincaré, Erlangen program by Felix Klein, theory of transient cardinal and ordinal numbers. Now, the itinerary of form in the 20th century. Forma structure, Ferdinand de Saussure, Cours de Linguistique Générale. Form as opposed to substance, Ernst Cassirer. Logical forms, Bertrand Russell, A.N. Whitehead, Principia Mathematica. The soul and the forms, Georg Lukács. Darcy Thompson, on growth and forms, proposes a uniform treatment of growing processes in the mineral, vegetal, and animal realm. Forms are viewed as a result of natural selection. David Hilbert, in the second and the third decade of the 20th century, gives a theory of formal systems, giving a rigorous treatment of the concept of a mathematical proof. This is towards to prevent difficulties of the type that appeared in the connection with Cantor's transient numbers. So it was also the formalized expression opposed to Russell's logicism and Brouwer's intuitionism. In the same period, the so-called Russian formalism is a school of the science of literature, where the form is considered as an artistic construction. Max Scheler writes about formalism in ethics, the emergence of gestalt psychology. Gestalt means form, importance of form in psychology. Keller writes about physical forms. Ernst Cassirer, philosophy of symbolic forms. You see what obsession of forms in all these first three decades of the 20th century. Prague Linguistic Circle, promoting structural linguistics, where study of formats and of functioning linguistics. 29, Husserl writes on the relation between formal logic and transcendental logic. André Jol, Einfache Form. Vladimir Prop, Morphology of the Folktale, where form is conceived as a reduction of variance to invariance. It had a major impact in the study of narrativity. 33, Leonard Bloomfield, Language, setting the basis of American linguistic structuralism. 35, Kurt Lewin publishes a dynamic theory of personality, a topological approach to psychology. 35, emergence of the Bourbaki treatise of mathematics based on some fundamental structures. 37, Rudolf Carnap, the logical syntax of language. 43, Louis Helmslev, the prolegomena to a theory of language, form is opposed to substance, both of them considered for both expression and content. 49, Claude Lévi-Strauss starts his structuralism in anthropology. 51, Zelig Harris, methods in structural linguistics, reference to meaning reduced at minimum. 52, Kurt Lewin, field theory in social science, again borrowed from physics, the idea of a field and joined with a topological approach. Radcliffe Brown, structure and function in social sciences. Reventlow developed the idea of rependium. Then in 70, Nobel laureate Jacques Monod and François Jacob, The Logic of the Living. Very important, the same year, René Huyck, Forms and Forces, where you have the marriage between the forms in the organic world and the forms in art. Then a basic work by Spencer Brown, second edition of his Laws of Form. René Thom, Structural Stability and Morphogenesis, and Dynamics of Forms in Biology and Linguistics by Means of Differential Topology. 72, Maturana and Varela, Autopoiesis and Cognition, The Realization of the Living. I spoke about them yesterday. 73, very important, Gregory Bateson, Steps to an Ecology of Mind. This is the starting moment of the second order cybernetics, including the observer, in contrast with Wiener cybernetics, which does not include the observer. 75, Varela, Calculus of Self-Reference. 75, Benoit Mandelbrot, The Fractal Geometry of Nature. 76, Gilles Deleuze and Guattari, The Rhizome. I spoke about it yesterday. 79, von Förster, The Cybernetics of Cybernetics, is an important name for second order cybernetics. 79, Douglas Hofstadter, Gödel, Escher, Bach, The Recursive Common Denominator of Logic, Visual Arts and Music. 1980, Prigozhin, From Being to Becoming, Study of Dissipative Structures. 83, David Bohm, Woolness and the Implicate Order. 91, Hofmeyer and Emege, Code, Duality and the Semiotics of Nature. 92, Breer, a Danish, Svensson Breer, Information and Consciousness. And 96, very important name in biology, Stuart Kaufman, At Home in the Universe. They all talk about this delicate problem about what does it mean information in biology. At 97, Stonier, Information and Meaning, the same evolutionary perspective. Thank you for attention. Excuse me. For
A small remark, it's not a question exactly.
Yeah.
You were asking whether there is something which is not an answer to a question.
Yeah.
At the beginning, okay? There are lots of things which are not answers to questions. For example, I just jotted down, for example, promises. Promises, when I promise something, when I, a threat, presentation, an introduction.
I promise you that I will give you a book.
Yeah.
You cannot imagine a question to which this is an answer. The question is very simple. What are you promising? The answer, I promise you that.
Well, if you, this is not how things happen.
Well,
it's not to be imagined that you ask, what are you promising me?
No, it seems to me it's a very normal dialogue. What are you promising? Answer. I promise you that I will give you a book.
I would agree with you on another aspect, that the promise includes a bit of information which is the object of the promise.
Yeah,
but,
well.
Okay, and also the insults, the greetings, the compliments.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So
thank you.
One
can talk about this, yeah.
Any other questions? Yes.
What's the difference between where my question just disappeared? Give me a second. What's the difference between communication about communication?
Between
communication about communication and noise.
And communication about the world.
And noise.
No, noise. And noise.
Noise.
Yeah.
Well, no relation. Communication about communication is just what you saw at this moment. I made a comment about her comment. You know, this is communication about communication. What has to do this with noise? You see, most of all, in any comment about another comment is such a communication about communication. It's nothing to do with noise. Well, you know, as a matter of fact, here I gave an abstract of what should be to talk to a class during a semester, maybe that. Yeah.
Well, the concept of noise, it's also full of connotations. For example, that comment about the other comment could be noise in the sense that is irrelevant or it's very uninformative.
No, the problem is noise should be in relation with what the source intended to communicate. That if noise is what by any means is impediment. It's what is what is opposed to what the source wants to communicate to the destination. Anything what is opposed to this is noise. So it is not an abstract idea of noise or philosophical idea, no. It is only related to what the source had to say.
Any other questions? Yes.
So near the beginning of the talk, you mentioned that math is for conveying information or conveys information, whereas poetry is for manipulating the mind. I find that somewhat surprising since from a certain perspective, math doesn't contain much information. I mean, you could imagine conveying to some aliens that we understand Newtonian mechanics very simply, and then you wouldn't actually have to tell them the proofs. It's just you only convey math because the destination isn't smart enough to figure it out on their own. Think of it as a discovery, whereas poetry does have information. So it's sort of an irony there, or?
Well, I agree that you know, to the extent, you have to observe something. There is no definition of information in Shannon theory. The only thing he defines is the quantity of information. As a matter of fact, what happened in physics also is energy. Well, it is defined the way to measure energy, but not energy in itself. So, and you say here again you have this conjugate pair about I spoke yesterday. Who gave definition of information? Exactly those people who were not concerned with a mathematical approach. Popper, for instance, because they spoke philosophically. But as soon what Einstein, I gave yesterday a quotation from Einstein, it was just about this. As soon as you want to put in a mathematical language, you have to reduce your aims and to restrict, you no longer define information. So I agree that, you know, there are about, I think you can count in the literature, more than 30 different definitions of informations. And there are so many, this is equivalent to no definition. Because it is impossible to make a choice. The problem is the following. To put it pragmatically, whether it is operational to work with the idea of information in the way it was concerned in the literature when we are dealing with a piece of poetry. You know, all attempts to apply the scheme of 11 components you saw there, all attempts to apply it to concrete analysis of a piece of poetry showed their irrelevance, their lack of they did not fit with the, it was a practical difficulty to apply all these components and functions to a piece of poetry or to a work of art. And this is why this scheme, because you see, Shannon proposed only about 5 components, but then a lot of other components were added by linguists, for instance, like psychiatrists, semioticians, and practically you cannot work with them in the analysis, an analysis of a piece of poetry, because in the reading of poetry, things happen in a completely different way. Just this distinction between subject and object is to a large extent cancelled. The reader belongs to the it is a component of the work of art, because the reading process determines to a large extent the way a piece of poetry is perceived. So I could say pragmatically it does not fit to work with poetic communication conveying some information. It was a practical difficulty. And the same for religious discourse is a practical difficulty to how to make all these separations.
I had a question about the same point. The question is, if I'm reading a poem and it affects me, isn't it affecting my abstractions of the world as opposed to my facts or information about the world? And at which point can we not say that since it's affecting the abstractions or the way I look at things as opposed to the things themselves, it has more information than, say, a set of facts?
No, I don't know if I am sure if I understand. Could you explain?
Well, so you're saying your personal interpretation or reading of things convey information unique to you. Another person will read it differently and will have a different. Is the issue of oral component in which you put emphasis in ways in which you communicate different aspects of the same text? Different people will communicate differently, correct? The tones of the oral communication are personal.
Well, these things are very delicate. We have to talk more. You have to see, to read all these works I gave as example, trying to apply Shannon. As a matter of fact, they all recognize, you will see, they almost never try to apply Shannon to literature. They try to apply them only in those arts which are devoid of, you don't have the semantic dimension is very poor. For instance, in music, in painting. Because they were convinced that the force of a piece of music is in its sonorous organization, not in its semantics. And this is a very long polemics, whether there exists or not meaning in music. No general agreement about these things. So this is why they try to apply Shannon theory in this field. But the attempts to apply them to literature are in many cases ridiculous. You will go to the details to say how they are developed, and then you get the answer why you don't. They had to renounce to these attempts. Practically, we don't know by what, you see, the scheme I gave is for communication under condition of sharp distinction between subject and object. When you no longer accept this sharp distinction, I don't know how to replace this respective scheme by another scheme. There is no law scheme. So this is a... if you want to penetrate more, the quotation I gave there, the conjugate pair proposed by D'Alembert, as soon as you approach the sensible word, obscurity prevails. They are related all. This is not by random that I propose this sequence of lecture, because each of them is based on the preceding ones. So it takes...